This is Willem from Inelnet Labs, and he's going to talk to you. Still one, okay. He's going to talk to you about stub resolving, all the pain it involves, and how he will fix it for you.
That's right. So I've been working on this library, the GetDNS library, which is a versatile stub resolver. And the presentation will go over the motivation for the versatile stub resolver and some of the hurdles it has to take. And also at the end, the infrastructural position of the stub resolver. And how it perhaps should change or should be different. So with living on the edge, I do not mean living on the edge of a abyss, but instead, you know, the edge of the network with the end user devices or the end users, opposed to the infrastructure or the network, the services that the users are using, and also the middle boxes which are hampering the users' traffic and the infrastructure that is eavesdropping on the users. And this is basically one of the primary motivations for the versatile stub. The initiative of the technical community to do encryption everywhere you can. Encrypt the paths from the end user until or to the service it is using, so that nothing in between can interfere or eavesdrop or do anything. And well, this is the DNS ecosystem. You have the authoritative servers, and they are hosted by DNS operators, TLDs, and they are queries by let me start at the edge, this part. That's where the stub resolver resides, in the device of the end user. And it sends its query to the recursive resolver, which then in turn iterates over the authoritative service to find the answer the user asked for. And the observation I want to make here is that the authoritative servers reside in the best networks. They have complete network transparency and they are easy to manage, etc. It's already, they have, so to say, the best end-to-endness properties. And it's already getting harder with the recursive resolvers, but the stub resolvers are by far in the most hostile end-to-endness environment, so to say. There's a lot of traffic engineering which interferes with what stub resolvers see, as also indicated by Petter in the previous talk. So to every initiative for a encrypted connection starts with the lookup of a address, and to be sure that you connect to the actual server, that the correct endpoint, you have to make sure that the address is correct. And DNSSEC can provide origin authentication. It's a method with which you can verify that the answer of your DNS query is indeed coming from the owner of the domain name. And the standard sort of when it was developed, it was made for the recursive resolver, but if you want to do encryption from the very end, the edge of the network, the end user to the service, we have to start right there and do DNSSEC validation at the stub resolver. Having that said, the web server also authenticates not the web server, the browser authenticates the web server by verifying the name on its TLS certificate. So, you know, if we're verifying that name, do we actually need to make sure we are connecting to the right address, because afterwards we are authenticating again. But there's DNS is more than just addresses. There are also referrals in the DNS. One of the best known example is perhaps the mail exchange record, which refers you to a different name. And of course you have to know that this is authentic. This could be, when this answer is spoofed, then in the end, you know, it, you will connect to the wrong name and TLS might authenticate, but it might authenticate for the wrong name, which is not the mail server for that the domain name you intended to connect to. So TLS authentication, that's another thing where DNSSEC can improve, because regular PKIX has the too many certificate authorities problem. Thus, any certificate authority can basically vouch for any DNS name. There's one certificate authority which I really like, which is Let's Encrypt. They hand out certificates for free, because it doesn't matter how pricey your certificate is, which you bought, how much you trust your certificate authority, because all the others are able to vouch for your name as well, so they can basically interfere with your TLS connection. So DNSSEC has a means to deal with that. You basically publish in your domain name a hash of the public key used for your TLS encryption, for the service of your TLS encryption. Another nice use case for DAIN is signaling of TLS support. For example, mail servers don't have interaction with the user. And so TLS for SMTP was before was opportunistic, in that you try it, if you don't get it, you fall back to plain text. So an interfering middle box could just let it fall back, because there was no, if it was using a certificate authority which was not recognized by the other end, then, you know, there was no way to convey that information to the user. So with DAIN, a mail server can check, well, this one does have TLS. I'm certain about it, but because it verified, I looked it up in the DNS, and I should be able to set up a secure connection for delivering the email. So now that, in contrast to regular PKIX, with DNSSEC, you have ultimately the root zone, or the DNS key of the root zone, that vouches for the delegation to the top-level domain. And the top-level domain has its own key that vouches for the second-level domain, and that's mostly where your service resides. So instead of having at least 1,500 certificate authorities, you have two. So there's the root key signing key, and it is the root of the DNS, and it is used to sign the top-level domains, as I just told you. So there is a problem, a hurdle, the first hurdle for a step resolver, which is trust anchor management, because there is a trust anchor management protocol, or a rollover protocol, so to say, but it's written for recursive resolvers. They assume a permanent running process with system privileges. You know, it is a protocol which look at the key, do you see a new key? Wait for 30 days. Is it still there? Okay, you can trust it. It might be the new key that starts signing, etc. This doesn't match step resolver properties. Step resolvers might be in an application. They don't run all the time. They might run only occasionally, and they're running with user privileges. So what I write to disk is also overwritable by other applications. Luckily, there's also RFC 7958, which defines a way to acquire the root key signing key. And it's this is done by publishing a XML file on the IANA.org site. And together with this XML file, there is a S/MIME signature, which could be verified with the ICANN root certificate authority, which has an expiry date, by the way. So I should read now a piece of the RFC. It is important to note that the ICANN certificate authority is not a DNSSEC trust anchor. Instead, it is an optional mechanism for verifying the content and origin of the XML and the certificate trust anchors. But it's very useful for bootstrapping the KSK. So in libgetDNS, we've implemented zero configuration DNSSEC. It's basically, if there's no trust anchor of the root DNS key while validating, doesn't validate, fetch new trust anchor from IANA with the verify with the ICANN root certificate authority. And if it matches, use that. And also make sure you track the root key so you don't, you know, on every query do a new fetch of the XML file of the trust anchors. Second hurdle is DNSSEC roadblocks, so mailboxes, especially customer premise equipment, they have forwarding resolvers which really break DNSSEC in various ways. Luckily, there is this RFC 8027 roadblock avoiders, which defines how to deal with that. Ultimately, the stub resolver has to be able to fall back to full recursion. GetDNS can do that too. Another motivation for libgetDNS or encryption everywhere is not just security or DNSSEC verification, but also privacy. So libgetDNS has been developed alongside the DNS over TLS standard and can thus set up a TLS connection to the upstream recursive resolver. There's a whole bunch of RFCs that deal with various aspects, like you have to keep the connection open, you have to make sure you can send multiple queries on the same connection, answers might come in out of order, all that sort of things. We've all implemented that in GetDNS. There is also, for authenticating the DNSSEC upstream resolver, currently we use pin sets, but this is not very scalable. Right? Every time you change the key of a recursive resolver or of a privacy resolver, you have to distribute the pin sets. So a better way would be, or typically, or very fitable for DNS, so to say, to do it with DANE. Store the TLSA record authenticating the upstream resolver in the DNS with the name for that resolver. During the last hackathon at IETF 100, I've implemented authenticating the upstream through the opportunistically set up TLS channel. And then, you know, when it authenticates, it upgrades so it may be used for regular DNS queries. Another interesting draft is the one that bundles the whole authentication or the DANE record for authenticating the upstream resolver together with a complete chain of trust, DNS trust, within a TLS extension. So you don't have to query for it anymore. It comes together with setting up these TLS connections, and this is also mentioned in the new draft, which talks about securing the path between the resolver and the authoritatives. Another interesting IETF effort is DNS over HTTPS. it's on the HTTPS port, so probably less hampered than the port for DNS over TLS. And also all the queries which take place in context of visiting a certain page then go over this channel to this specific website. So I think this has a lot of potential and we should track it very closely. NAT 6.4, DNS 6.4 is a hurdle. From IPv6 only networks, you still want to reach IPv4 only servers. This is done by synthesizing the IPv6 answer, which can obviously not be DNSSEC verified. So a versatile step should detect the synthesis, then ask for the actual answer and do the synthesis itself. So this RFC was originally for DNSSEC validating steps, but it also applies to DNS over TLS. This is was, I think, not foreseen with this RFC yet, but so it is. Another motivation for having a versatile step close to the application and the end user is that DNSSEC at the recursive resolver, when it fails, it tells the user this by not answering. So the user doesn't know anything about why it didn't work. With the library, the browser could say, well, you know, this seems like a genuine spoofed answer to me, so you should probably not connect. Or, oh, the signature's expired, you choose, do you want to continue or not? Same with DNS privacy, it could indicate what kind of privacy you have with your DNS queries. So this is the positioning of the infrastructural component of the step interface. Traditionally, it was with two system or calls, get other info and get name info. And then if you needed something more complex, like a MX record query, you used a resolver library, like libresolve or libfal LDNS, which would then read etc.resolve.conf or get the addresses otherwise and query the upstream recursive resolvers directly. But then legacy applications cannot benefit from versatile step capabilities like DNS over TLS. So some of those versatile step resolvers, I list a few here, have a step server to make let all applications use the step server capabilities. These step servers do that by listening on localhost. And there's also systemd resolver, which has does it slightly different. It has its own NS switch module, but also listens on localhost for applications that need to look up MX records, etc. Unfortunately, serving part of systemd resolve does not serve DNSSEC, so it cannot be used for that. I submitted a GitHub issue for it. The application should do access the dbus API of systemd resolve directly. So I just wanted to end this positioning step resolver story, or the architectural story, with this picture. This is the after part is where we're heading, and maybe there should be some standardization work or other ways of discussing things with amongst the step resolver developers, because they're not that well organized. So that was my talk. En dat is een perfecte.
Thank you, Willem. We can do one quick question.
Hi there. I agree with the principle of securing DNS traffic, but there's in some cases a conflict of concern. So when I'm outside my home with my laptop, my tablet, I want full security.
Yeah.
In my house, I don't, in the context that, when, because I want to block adverts and stuff,
yes.
I have a mix of devices. I want my local resolver to black hole some addresses, in particular for devices with tablets where I can't put ad blockers on. So DNS is the only mechanism to rewrite things.
Yeah.
With this in place, once, for example, Apple put this into their devices, I lose the ability then to rewrite because of DNSSEC in the client.
All right.
How do you handle that confliction between the need to control the traffic and the security?
Yeah. Negative DNSSEC trust anchors. So you can say this specific domain cannot DNSSEC validate. There's no proof that it's insecure, but I want you to, you know, assume it's insecure and accept the data because it's in my own setup. So that's the technical answer. And so and there's a professional answer, which is more complicated, of course, or the professional question. So I don't know how to do that, but HomeNet is working on that, I think, at the ITF, so.
Okay, thanks, Willem.
Yeah, you're welcome. Oh, yeah, can I mention one, there's more slides after this slide. So if you download the presentation, there's a whole new presentation telling you how to install GetDNS, code examples,
etc. Yes,
yeah. Very good.
Okay.
Thanks.